Good evening. So Mike said, after Mr. Watkins done, you just come up and introduce Doug. And I said, so you're going to introduce me? He said, no, no, you just introduce yourself. So I'll be off having a beer with whoever gets your own umbrella question, right? That's what he is. For anyone that doesn't know me, I'm Mike Emery. I spent 12 years, first 12 years of my career at Montville High School, teaching math and coaching a whole bunch of different sports. You know, I was listening to Jeff talk about the first state championship that Montville had ever gotten into. I brought back memories. It's not part of my prepared thing, but it did bring back memories of being Tommy Alco's assistant on that team in the semifinal game. And just give you an idea of what kind of athlete Doug was. We were, I don't remember the exact circumstance, Mark probably remembers it, I'm sure, but it was a close game in the semifinal game. I think we were maybe down by one or so. And there was a timeout, and Tommy gathered the kids together and did what basketball coaches do, which is, all right, we're going to foul, and if he misses the first one, we're going to do this. But if he makes the first one and misses the second, we're going to do this. If he makes them both, you would have to be the valedictorian of Massachusetts Institute of Technology to figure out all the different scenarios that we were going to do with what might happen to them. What he neglected to say was, all right, when they pass the ball to the point guard and he brings it up the floor, Doug, you just steal it from him and go in for a layup and we'll win the game. And that's exactly what happened. We were on to the finals. So, that's Doug's basketball career. Let's go to football. December 5th, 1981. The Montville Indians are in a back-and-forth battle with St. Joseph's of Trumbull. Probably some of you were there. For the Connecticut Class S State Championship. The Indians are led by future Nebraska Cornhusker and San Francisco 49er, Doug Dubose. And St. Joseph's is coached by Ed McCarthy, who would go on to become the winningest coach of all time in the state of Connecticut. The game was characterized by St. Joseph's long, methodic drives and Montville's quick strikes. Mostly long electric runs by Dubose, mixed in with quick play-action passes from Scott Vendetto to Doug's cousin, Troy Turner. It was at that time, remember this was before the spread offense was invented, that coach, the highest point total in the history of Connecticut State Championships. St. Joseph's took the lead 37-30 with about 2 minutes left on the clock. The Indians were scoring fast, and it seemed like plenty of time for Montville to either tie it up or with a two-point conversion win the game outright. The drive began after the kickoff at the Montville 35-yard line. St. Joseph's elected to kick the ball out of bounds rather than kick the ball to Dubose or Kenny Gray. McCarthy did not win all the games because he was stupid. On a side note, at the beginning of the previous season, when Doug's brother Gary was also on the team, Doug and Gary Dubose combined for a remarkable 5 touchdowns on punt and kickoff returns only against NFA in the first game of the season. Montville never saw an inbounds kick for the next 2 years. Everyone kicked out of bounds after that against us. Doug and Gary would have to both wait to show their open field running ability until they got to Nebraska and UConn. So the drive begins, and yours truly was the play caller. Play calling had been pretty simple that year. Get in trouble, not sure what to do, give the ball to Doug. He always bailed us out with some incredibly acrobatic, graceful, and jaw-dropping run. He was truly, and I mean this, poetry in motion. But this was different. There wasn't much time left, and we only had one timeout, and St. Joseph's was pretty good. We worked our way down to the 20-yard line, and my mind was racing. We knew that a strong play against St. Joseph's prevent defense was something we called 20 trap. As another side note, I was personally burned one night in 1999 by another Montville running back running 20 trap when I was coaching at Fitch. Jeremy Turner ran it over and over and came inches of stealing an undefeated season away from us that year. But back to 1984, I was in a quandary. Give the ball to Doug doesn't get in, be forced to call our final timeout or call something else. I decided to throw one more pass and hopefully get the ball to around the 10 and then give the ball to Doug for the winning touchdown. So let's recap. Give the ball to the best running back that our area has ever seen, or pass the ball just one more time. Does it sound familiar to anybody? Mm-hmm. Are there any Seahawks fans out there? If you ask a Seahawks fan, they'll tell you how it turned out, and it turned out that way for us too. That's right, the pass was intercepted. We've all been home, heartbroken. And here we are 34 years later, and I can honestly tell Pete Carroll, Pete, you may be the most positive thinker in the history of football, but your heart will sink every time you think of that decision. I know mine does. I'm a huge Patriot fan, and as soon as Malcolm Butler intercepted that pass and I got done jumping up and down, the next thought in my brain was, why didn't you give the ball to Doug 34 years ago? If we had, Montville would have their first state championship 34 years ago. Now, in my defense, we were on the 20-yard line, not the 1-foot line. But still, in my heart, I truly have always believed that had I called 20 trap, Doug would have somehow gotten into that end zone, and we would have won the championship. Of course, Doug went on to play with Nebraska and with the 49ers, All-American at Nebraska, and, of course, NFL pro football player. And every time he touched the ball, no matter what level he was playing, he still ran with that same swashbuckling style that he developed at Montville High. Truly a joy to watch for anyone, whether you knew him personally or not. But for those few of us who knew Doug and knew him well, our hearts filled with pride every time he took the field. Yes, it was a proud, exciting time in Montville, Connecticut, every time your number was called in college and in the pros. I wish I could do a Keith Jackson imitation. You guys have all grew up with Keith Jackson and college football. But just close your eyes and listen to Keith at the beginning of every game, given the starting lineup, and you can almost hear him say, and for the Cornhuskers at the IBAC is Doug Dubose from Uncasville, Connecticut. And what a great feeling it was to hear that on the TV. Doug, you made a lot of people proud when those words were spoken. I can tell you that the whole Montville football family at that time felt like we were on the field with you when we watched you play. Congratulations on tonight. I can't think of anyone more worthy than you to be one of the inaugural members of this great new tradition. And looking at the other inductees, who I know a lot of them, you are in wonderful company. And I'd like to say that the best thing about tonight, you guys have organized it for me personally, was to reconnect with old friends. One of my favorite groups of people in Montville with the Dubose family has been great catching up in the last couple of days with Doug, Gary, Peaches, and Sandra, and the whole Dubose crew. So thank you to Montville for making this happen, and congratulations again to Doug and all the rest of the honorees. And I'd like to bring Doug and Gary up right now to accept the award. Gary wants to say a few words too.
I don't have to say nothing now. He said my battery's getting low.
First of all, I'd like to thank you all for showing up here tonight. And it's been a tough week for us. We lost Nod this week, and we almost weren't able to make this ceremony, but things worked out. What I did realize was you don't always get a chance to say what you want to some of your loved ones. And I just wanted to make sure I let my brother know that I'm proud of him, that all the times that we played in the yard, backyard against each other, competition-wise, you know, 20 feet away, a wet tennis ball, throwing it against the board, so we wouldn't have arguments about the strike zone. Just had a lot of good times, and I'm so proud of him. He's been through a lot of adversity, but I've always been with him. My family's always been with him. I just wanted to continue to be the best man that he can be. And I really do thank you all of you for the support. And I love you, little brother.
I can't promise I'm not going to cry. So, and I brought my best of all my advice tonight, so it's going to be God blessing. But I got some tea crumbs. I got a whole lot of talking up, but I hook out all day tonight. Drag me off the stage. And I got a whole book in there. Okay. First, I want to thank Phil and Tanner for doing such a great job and getting this Hall of Fame thing started. It was a long time coming. And it's truly a dream come true, you know, to represent Montville. And, you know, the place where I grew up and I call home, even though I don't live in Montville anymore, but when people say, where do you live? I say, no, I'm from Montville. And then they say, Montville, where's Montville? I said, you know where the casino's at, right? They know where the casino's at. Also, I want to thank Coach Oliver. He was a big part of my life. I'm sorry he couldn't be here today, but he was a person, man, that taught me a lot besides my dad. You know, he was hard on me, but you know, that's how my dad was. You know, he knew my potential, and he knew that I had to live up to it. And that's how Ed was. And I remember, I think it was my senior year, my junior year, I was a quarterback, so my brother was a running back. And Ed would call me over to the sidelines. And, you know, he would say, Doug, you know, these kids is talking in the huddle. Doug, you're not running the team right, Doug. It really didn't go like that. I just went away, and I'm not going to cuss or anything. He would have smoke coming out of his nose, right? He'd bite the lip. Come here, Doug. He turned me away from the team like this. And he would say, get that beep, 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 team ready to play, or I'm gonna beep, 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 your ass. I would go back and cuddle crying. And the guys were like, what happened? And I said, he chewed my ass out. And I thank Ed, man, for just making me the man that I am today. I see a lot of coaches that coached Armando, late Tom Hawkins. You know, he really taught me a lot. And who really taught was my dad. You know, I'm real emotional talking about my dad. My dad died 15 years ago, and he was the hardest on me. I was first a wide receiver when I started playing. And the first game I played in, I caught a pass and I scored a touchdown on the first pass I caught. And the coach said, man, he said, you know, we gotta get you the ball more. So he said, well, we're moving back to running back. So the next game they gave me the ball six times and I scored all six times. And I got in the car, my dad said, man, you stink. I said, yeah, I put deodorant on. He said, no, not stink like that, you stunk on the football field today. So I was thinking, I said, I scored six touchdowns. But I knew what he was doing. You know, he didn't want me to be content with myself. He wanted me to work hard every day. And he wanted me to go out there to bust my behind and get better. And, you know, he went on, and he's always telling me, you know, my dream was to be a pro athlete. And he said to me, he said, you know, right now you're playing with these little kids. And then, you know, when I got to high school, I said, Dad, the kids are bigger now. And he said, yeah, it's going to be a little tougher. And, you know, it was tough in some ways. And he said, you still got a couple more levels to get to. So I went to Nebraska, and, you know, the competition there was pretty tough. And so he told me, he said, you're at one of the top universities, son. He said, I don't know if you picked the area. He said, I had about 10 colleges I could have picked from. And Nebraska was known for their Outbacks at the time. We had a couple Heisman Trophy winners. And he thought I would get lost in a shuffle like a lot of people in Connecticut did. But I always knew, you know, I had confidence in myself. And I felt that, I had the potential to do it. And so I went, I ended up going to Nebraska, and he said, son, you have to bust your ass. And as a sophomore, I started. I was the first sophomore and junior to rush for 1,000 yards. And then going into my senior year, they had picked me to win the Heisman Trophy, and I got hurt. And that was a big blow to me, you know. Going from the first pick in the NFL draft, they had me projected as, and then not even getting drafted, you know. So it was a lot of trials and tribulations, man, where I had to sit down and get everything, my thoughts and my head right again, man. You know, it was the toughest time of my life. But I grinded, man, I worked my ass off again, man, to get back, to get my knees strong again, and to make the 49er team. And, you know, we went on to win the Super Bowl. I played 3 seasons with him. I had a great time. And it was because of Montville, this stuff that Montville taught me to be a man. And, I mean, as far as growing up, my coaches, my parents, beating my brother up every day. just the tough things in life. And, from backyard playing football with little Kimmy. She was my Kimmy. That's Mr. Jasper. To Mr. Jasper, they were my next door neighbors when I was growing up. And I was the kind of guy, I wanted to play football every day outside. And I didn't have nobody to play with. So I made Kimmy my quarterback. And she was probably about 10 years old, right? And we played against her brother Kevin, another guy named Jack Cunningham. And she said, how can I get you the ball? I said, just throw it up in there. I can go get it. And I would jump over those guys and catch it, right? And we would play in the snow. It didn't matter what. I would wake them guys up and they can play with me. You know? And I want to thank Mr. Jaspers for always being there for me. You know? My next door neighbor for years. And Mrs. J, for help me raise my kids. You know? She was a possible lady. And, I want to thank some other people in my life that has helped me get to where I am at. My sister, who I love dearly. She's been with me through thick and thin, you know, through the hard times, through the good times. She truly one of my rocks. I love her. My kids, I got 2 of my kids here, Jordan and Trey. You guys are inspiration. You guys are the reason why I do what I do every day, you know. To show you guys, to make an example, you know. My brother, you know, man, he knows how I feel about my love and death. And my 3 rocks, my mom, my Lara, my girlfriend, Annette. My mom is always, you know, she's been through hell, you know. I haven't always done the right things in life. And, you know, I mean, through the NCAA and investigating us, you know, and then putting my mom through a lot of stuff. And, you know, just the rigors of having a son playing big-time football and going through this stuff, you know. And she's always stuck by my side, you know, and always tried to teach me to do better. You know, I always didn't listen, but I always heard her. And my Laura, my second mom, you know, Troy's mom, Troy, my cousin, just like my brother, is his mom, my second mom. She's tougher than my real mom, you know, she stays home. She's like, yeah, she called me and, yeah, what are you doing? I'm tired, I'm laying down. You just got woke, just woke up an hour ago. I said, damn, I can't go back to sleep. Come on, Alana. But I know she loves me and I know it's always for the best interest. My Uncle Tony, my space partner, I love you, man. And, my girlfriend Lynette, you know, she's been with me through thick and thin. We had a 15-year-old son together, and she's been through the rigors with me, and always stuck by my side, and I love her for it. And last but not least, I like to talk about my cousin Troy. You know, he was a big part of my life, and he got murdered. 10 years ago. He was like a brother to me. And I really miss him, man. He's the reason why I'm at where I'm at today, the reason why I got to Nebraska, you know. He took some of the pressure off of me, you know. And, you know, he was a hell of a guy, man. We laughed. We played hard, you know. We had a good time together. But, you know, when it was time to get serious, he got serious. And that's his two little sisters back then, my cousin Angie and Tony. And I want to let them know I love them, man. They always got my back. Anything I need, I know I can come to them and ask them for it. I love you too. And all my friends who came, Eileen Plikas, the Plikases, Maria Caporel, everybody that came out, man, just showing me support. You know, I really appreciate it, man. It really means a lot to me, it really does. You know, I'm humbled, you know, to get into the first inauguration of the Hall of Fame. It really means a lot to me, man, it does. I'm gonna represent Montville. And, you know, the next step is camp for me. You know, the Hall of Fame in Ohio, Pro Football Hall of Fame. I'm just joking. You got it. Is it gonna make it? Hell no. I'm not gonna get to it. Maybe the Nebraska Hall of Fame. But I want to thank, like I said, thank Tanner. Thank God. Thank everybody for coming tonight, man. It was a wonderful evening. Great celebration. Thank you, guys.
Class of 84, Kim Hawkins.